So, ladies and gentlemen, I am utmost glad that the regulators, under the lead of the chair of Rudolf Strohmeier, have decided to be again in Basel. I'm especially very, very glad that also Mrs. Sadala from IMI has decided to be in Basel. We are very grateful to you for that, because we feel that regulators and industry must come in this way together to discuss questions of the near future, of the introduction of the translation of drugs, and the last station of it is always the FDAs and also those who are deciding in large pharma. So thank you very much, and I would like to ask you, Rudolf, to take over.
Well, good afternoon. I'm very pleased to open this session, the regulation environment in nanomedicines and targeted medicine, because this session follows very well on session number 5 that took place yesterday afternoon about assessing complex drug similarity, the regulation of follow-up on nanomedicines and non-biological complex drugs. To have this discussion today, we have a very distinguished panel of regulatory officials and experts from mainly all regions of the world. For the sake of time, because I realize, being the fourth time here at Cleanham, there's a lot of, let's say, demand for Q&A, and so I will not introduce everybody in detail because you have everything in the program. Just let me introduce them very briefly. From Europe, we have Mr. Ehmann from the European Medicines Agency in London. From Japan, we have Mrs. Kumiko Sakai Kato. She is in the Ministry of Health, Labor and Welfare in Tokyo. I think it's the second or third time we meet here. We have from Canada, Mrs. Shahbazian. She is from the Office of Science, Therapeutic Products Directorate in Health Canada. USA is represented by Mr. Weichold from the Food and Drug Administration. We have from Africa Mr. Paul Ori from the Nigerian National Agency for Food and Drug Administration and Control. And to close the round, we have again from Europe Ms. Fatia Zadala from the Innovative Medicines Initiative 2 in Brussels. Let me start with a few remarks. The medical regulatory environment for the approval of new drugs and medical products is extremely important in the research innovation circle, since it determines to a large extent the development and cost and time to market introduction. The challenges for the regulatory authorities to regulate the complex market approval for nanomedicines are considerable. On the one side, patients expect that the regulatory authorities guard the quality, safety, and efficacy of medical therapies and products, but at the same time deliver fast. And on the other side, the cost of development and the duration of the approval process need to be reduced to the minimum possible, again, both for the interest of the patient, but also industry. To match these demands, there's a strong need for global harmonization of medical regulatory systems, assessment procedures, and standardization, as well as mutual recognition and trust building. In the interests of the patients, it makes no sense that regulators work in isolation, reinventing individually the wheel. Therefore, last year it was agreed at Clinam that the various regions of the world would liaise regularly with one another with a view to harmonize the various regulatory requirements between them. This idea was implemented by a declaration on close cooperation in the field of nanotechnologies made by medical regulatory authorities from Australia, Canada, the EU, EMA, Japan, and the US. My first question, to which I invite our panelists to respond, is therefore, what progress has been achieved with the coordination since then? Is there a dialogue structure being built? Are you content with the sharing of information, to give some ideas? A second set of questions is relating to the fact that more and more substances are presented to the regulators. What kind of risks can we take to help patients desperately looking for new therapies, in particular if their life expectancy is diagnosed to be very short? To put it bluntly, what is the trade-off between risks and benefits before the patient has died? Do we need to establish risk categories? Do we need to differentiate between active and inactive substances? Which are criteria for differentiations? How to involve the patients if nanomedicine is a pathway to personalized medicine? A last question to the panel follows from the discussions of yesterday afternoon. Well, to be honest, the discussion stopped before it became really interesting. How do we want to deal with generics in nanomedicine? So, against this background, I would like to invite our speakers to limit themselves to 8 minutes for a short statement. After the statements, my idea would be to have a short round among themselves and then to open the discussion with you in the audience. So may I first invite Mr. Falk Ehmann from IMA in London.
Thank you very much for this nice introduction, and I asked to see some slides. So I will focus on the first issue highlighted by our chair, what progress has been made since last year. And I'm speaking a bit of all people present here, because we took your demand serious, and I think we established something very, very useful, especially in terms of the international regulation of nanomedicines. It is maybe something which is more important on a later stage of development, but it is something that needs to be in place to ensure that you have a global market. So it is something really considered of value. As mentioned before as well, a lot of items on EU guidance and EU products have been presented during the meeting yesterday. So I will not repeat this one. Have the next slide, please. So basically, it starts really early. Do we have a common understanding what is a nanomedicine or what is a product which contains nanotechnology? If we don't even know what we're talking about, maybe in one region of the world we understand a different product category than in another one. This is basically the case. So it starts really with a simple thought: can we agree on something that we know we're talking about the same issue? I just put here a proposal on there, but it is not agreed by all regions yet, and there is a different understanding. And this is something really a prerequisite to start and talk and give you guidance in the right way, in a harmonized way. So we could talk about purposely designed systems in the nanoscale. Do we talk about 1 to 1,000 nanometers? But what if it's 1,010 nanometers? I think we almost agree that it should have definable specific properties and characteristics for its intended use, which lead to a clinical advantage. Next slide, please. So, preceding the declaration from last year was Nanomedicine's working group, a teleconference, basically, which we held biannually or sometimes twice a year between the major regions, including Health Canada, FDA, Japan, and Europe. We had 12 webinars so far since 2009, and we discussed, for example, the definition, sharing of product-related methods, and we co-drafted guidance. And as mentioned last year, this is the last bullet point, in 2014, it was agreed to further strengthen that. So what did we do since then? There is another forum which has been established as kind of a forum under the umbrella of the ICH, the International Committee of Harmonization. And this is called the International Pharmaceutical Regulators Forum, IPRF. And their intention is to harmonize, to cooperate, and work share between the regions. And they're not specific to the three main regions of the ICH, i.e. US, Japan, and Europe, but they're open to all regulators all over the world. And it was proposed to this forum last November 2014 to establish a nano group. And they did that, and we agreed 2 weeks ago under the ICH meeting in Japan to establish a nano working group under the IPF umbrella. And we adopted a mandate, and we drafted a work program for the first year, which has not been finalized at this stage. Now, since then, we have new members, and these include the Chinese Taipei, South Korea, Brazil, Swissmedic, and Singapore. And today, we have a colleague sitting here in the panel from Africa, and we're very happy to have one more member in our group. The chair will be rotating on a 12-month basis, and the work plan has to be agreed and sent to the IPRF steering committee or managing committee, which is currently chaired by Swissmedic. Now, this is the draft or the adopted mandate, and apologies for the small print. I think I'd like to highlight two issues here. One thing is that, of course, we talk about nanomaterial and drug products / nanomedicines, because there's even no agreement on the term what we're talking about, not to talk about what we mean under this. Nanomedicines is not a term which is agreed in all regions. And we include as well methodologies used during the development of these products, because listening to what has been presented in the last 1.5 days and until tomorrow here at Cleanup, it makes very clear that methodologies play a major role. And looking at outside the presentations and the stands, it's very clear that it plays a major role. Composition is a rotating chair. We can invite scientists, and any regulator over the world can participate. And in terms of deliverables, these, I think, we will further define in a work program or work plan, which is adopted on an annual basis. Now, this is, again, just a draft work plan, and today we discussed it much, much further. And there I'd like to thank especially Beat and the Cleanup for making this possible. There's currently no funding or money available to meet a face-to-face, to meet these all regions together. And we really took the chance to meet here at Cleanup, because a high proportion, as you can see in the panel, was present to discuss it and to agree on something, what is possible and what is not possible. And this is really, really a unique chance. So, Beat, thank you very much for this in the name of all of us. We made a major step forward. More work to do now, but that's the nature of the attitude. And we agreed on three to four topics. These will be communicated on the IPRF website and will then hopefully be beneficial to all of you. This is a bit advertisement of what we did in the EU. now talking about the European Medicines Agency, at least one slide is my last slide, and I have 2.5 minutes, so I think I did well in timing. What do we have here in Europe? If you're interested in engaging with the regulator as soon as possible, there's the SME office for small and medium-sized enterprises. You can register there at any stage of your drug development as long as you're somehow based in Europe, and you have major incentives in terms of drug development, being it asking for scientific advice or even for marketing authorization. Then we have the Innovation and Technology Fora, ITF, and this is something you can request informal briefing meetings, and then we look at experts all over Europe or regulators who can assist you in any stage of drug development as well. It's an informal chat, we can have it over TC, it's free of charge. More formal engagements include scientific advice and the qualification of novel methodologies. This is a fee-related issue, but again, there are incentives for small and medium-sized enterprises. And there you get an official feedback by the European agency. And they have in paper published that if you follow this kind of advice, the likelihood for positive marketing authorization on a later stage are higher. And this is it for my side. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Falk. And I think it's already positive what you reported, that CLINAM is some kind of a driver for regulatory cooperation. The next speaker on our list is our colleague from Japan, Mrs. Sakai Kato. You have the floor.
Thank you very much. I'm very glad to join this session again. So the new activity about the international dialogue between the regulators was introduced by EMA. So I'd like to introduce and update the activity of regulatory science of nanomedicines in Japan. So in Japan, the importance of regulatory science in the development and innovative products such as nanomedicines was highlighted in the fourth Science and Technology Basic Plan, started from 2011, based on the Science and Technology Basic Plan, and also in the fundamental policy issues by the Cabinet Office. So furthermore, the promotion of regulatory science has recently been legislated in the Action of Promotion of Healthcare Policy. So to provide an environment that facilitates the development of innovative drugs, so it is essential to develop suitable product evaluation methods and to issue assessment guidelines. So to that end, experts in Japan have been examining the evaluation method of nanomedicines, and with the support of research grant by MHLW. So considering the research outcome, guidelines for the development and the evaluation of nanomedicines are drafted. So Japanese experts, including the Japanese ICH guideline experts, are discussing. And after public consultations, the draft will be finalized and issued from Japanese MHLW. So as last year, we introduced the Japanese MHLW published a reflection paper of block polymer, which was a collaboration with EMA. So after the publications of reflection paper, Japanese experts continued to discuss the evaluation of block polymer. And recently, we have published the review paper entitled General Considerations Regarding the In Vitro and In Vivo Properties of Block Polymer Micelle Product and Their Evaluations. So in this review paper, in vitro and in vivo characteristics of block polymer micelle product are presented, so mainly focusing on the products under current clinical investigations. Examples of methods for evaluation of physicochemical properties, non-clinical pharmacokinetics, and safety of block polymer micelle products were also presented. So please refer to the paper, review paper. Based on the regional guidelines, including the Japanese pharmacopoeia or the internationally harmonized ICH guidelines for the quality, safety, and efficacy evaluation of general drug products, Japanese experts are discussing what additionally should be considered for the development in, and evaluations of nanomedicines. So typical particle size measurement techniques, dynamic light scattering techniques, has already been included in the Japanese pharmacopoeia as general informations. So thank you very much. This is an update of Japanese situations.
Thank you very much. If we continue like that, we will have even the possibility for two rounds. So may I now turn to our Canadian colleague, Ms. Shahbazian. Put you.
Thank you. Could I control it from here? Okay, this is it. All right. Because there has been a slight modification of required items, I'm just going to skip a few slides here. Okay. So, Health Canada's Health Protection and Food Branch is responsible for regulating medicinal products and healthcare products in general that include pharmaceuticals, radiopharmaceuticals, biologics, natural health products, and medical devices. Health products are regulated on primary emphasis on product safety and effectiveness, utilizing risk-benefit analysis to receive approval. In Health Canada, we had to have some kind of a high-level guide because there isn't sufficient information to come up with specific guidance to simply have a central place where companies could go to see what we intend to do with the products that contain nanomaterials. And it provides simply information that we encourage the stakeholders to come and discuss it with Health Canada prior making a submission to find out what type of information would satisfy Health Canada. And in general, to start this process early on so they can be ready when they submit their submission. There have been a number of products submitted that may be considered nano as per new definition that we have in place. And based on the definition that Health Canada has adopted, we have modified our application form to include a place where manufacturer can self-declare whether their product contains or is a nanomaterial in order to be able to at least track a number of products that are coming in as nanomaterial. And maybe later on we could look at their performance post-market environment. Same with medical devices. This year, medical devices has revised their application form and included a little area where manufacturer can simply confirm whether or not their product is considered to be a nano product per se. And the Bureau will eventually put this in their database so it would be trackable and we can generate reports. Now, in addition to these products, we also deal with combination products, and we know that combination products will be more prevalent when nanotechnology comes to play, and there will be many variations of combinations, and combination products are already difficult because they don't fit in any specific regulation, and often you have to make a decision based on simple criteria that don't necessarily address the difference in the nature of a product. Sometimes you cannot differentiate device from a drug or a biologic, so it comes like one system, and it's important to have a way of addressing that type of complexity and addressing them underneath the appropriate regulatory framework. We do not have any specific guidances at this time, and we always feel that so whatever information is available publicly and we learn from these wonderful conferences that we attend, there isn't really final decision on any aspect of methodologies and so on. So to generate a guidance, you have to give some kind of a guidance. It can't be just guidance for sake of listing things. So at this point, we haven't reached to the knowledge level where the guidance would be meaningful. And we're applying the existing regulations because nanoproducts are either drugs, devices, so they fit underneath the existing legislation. But we address them case-by-case basis because we know that nanotechnology introduces these unique characteristics to the product. There are a number of issues we're all facing as regulator, even as a developer, to know whether our product is safe and effective. So the only answer is to work with our partners globally, in-house and within our international environment. So Health Canada tries to work and collaborate as much as we can. And these international engagements take bilateral agreements, memorandums of understanding. In some cases, we can have complete submission discussion because there is a confidence on both sides. And we're also involved in other applications where we could learn from our colleagues, and also a number of documents that they are working on. There is a common review area. We will share this information and discuss through our international regulators forum. We're involved in a number of international collaborations that are dealing with nanotechnology, like ISO 229 Technical Committee, OECD on manufactured nanomaterials, Canada-US Regulatory Cooperation, International Cooperation on Cosmetic Regulations, and now our International Regulators Working Group is in transition under to IPRF umbrella, as Falk has described, and we feel that this is giving us an exposure because it will be publicly available as a working group underneath the Regulators Forum as one of the subgroups. They have four other subgroups already in place, and Nano is a new addition. And actually, it initiated at the last meeting here when we had a closed meeting with our working group members. This proposal was put on the table, then it was presented to the managing committee, and EMA did a great job of presenting collective agreement to it. And now this is, I think, official. And so pretty soon you will see some documentation that will address the mandate and the work items. And we had another meeting this afternoon at lunchtime with our colleagues that are sitting here around the table and discussed the work items, what is a priority, what is a doable project within a short period of time. So we even assigned tasks. Folk was very productive. So in conclusion, we're not introducing anything new, but rather we're raising awareness. And we want people to recognize that there is a difference. When there is a nano involved, we should always be a little more cautious and ask for additional information if we're not comfortable what we're seeing in the evidence that's presented to us. And in order to identify and assess this information, we have to work together. And hopefully we will have some guidances in the near future where we could share that guidance and harmonize on that level. So we're all asking similar type of information. And we will start by defining what nanomedicine is in the first place and some of the elements that go with the nano. Thank you. This is just a list of my colleagues' names from different directories that are part of Health Protection Branch. And I also have the Strategic Policy Branch science address there, and they are responsible for new technologies. They are the group who managed the working group that created the working definition. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this insight. I turn now to Frank Weichold from the United States.
Thank you. I certainly consider myself very lucky to have such excellent and competent colleagues to work with internationally, and as such I also do not have to repeat some of the accomplishments of the work in the past 2 years actually, or perhaps specifically in the last year. And I will go to perhaps some of the specific questions. How much progress have we made, and what kind of progress have we made? I would call it steady progress. I would call it continuous progress, and I would also remind you it is a gradual progress. So have I changed FDA in the past 2 years? Not yet. But since I promised it, I guess 2 years ago, I'm still working on it. But let me specifically talk about some of the issues that we are dealing with and also remind you of some of the infrastructure and underlying principles as we deal with specifically nanotechnology. For risk-benefit evaluations, I would make reference, because I don't have any specific information to share with you today, that you would look that up at the FDA websites under REMS, or REMS, standing for Risk Evaluation and Mitigation Strategies. There is specific information, and also the scientific underpinnings are quite well explained. And if you develop additional questions in that context, please contact us and we will get in discussion and dialogue. And specifically to the generics, my colleague from FDA, CDER, specifically the Office of Generic Drugs, Bin Lai Young, has had the opportunity to present yesterday specifically on how we approach generic regulation, and as such, I'm not going to repeat it, but since the slides are available, I would again like to make reference to that. Now, nanotechnology coordination at FDA is certainly in context of the National Nanotechnology Initiative, and we have formed a task force for nanotechnology that includes all the centers and super or main offices, including the Office of the Chief Scientist, and is orchestrated through the Office of the Chief Scientist and supported. The charter of the Nano Task Force includes scientific education, defining regulatory research priorities in the field. We include staff training, because we know that when new technology comes to the agency, even though we do not regulate technology, you have to have the knowledge. We cannot regulate product if you don't understand it, and as such, training is very important, and certainly, as we have learned today, we have a great interest in defining and supporting consensus standards as well. Just a little detail for you to know, if there's a working group in a government organization, it is good to charter it, because otherwise it cannot serve as a resource or an advisor to a decision-making process. As such, this group was also chartered. Now here I'm going a little bit more into the weeds, because the centers at FDA are rather large, and some of the representation of the centers is actually subgroups that deal with specific organizational substructure, like the Nanotech Reviewer Network, specifically in CDER, and again, a CDER-specific subgroup that coordinates research discussion is the NWG. We have research laboratory facilities that have state-of-the-art equipment. As I mentioned, we want to measure things, and you cannot regulate if you don't enforce regulation, and if you cannot understand product, then you have to wonder. Now, one of the important points to raise again is that nanotechnology products can be challenging and scientifically complicated, but they are classified and assigned review processes in the same consideration as any other product, because FDA does not regulate technology. We regulate the product in which form ever, and that which ever underpinning technology comes to the agency. And as such, it will not surprise you that we categorize and divert or direct applications into the centers. Now, there are situations where we have combination products that truly include either biologics and drugs, or devices and drugs, or other variations thereof, and as such, we had to come to par with it. Now, I also want to remind you that regulation happens in the U.S. on the basis of statutes, statutory authority, which is the law, and regulation also happens in, let me circumscribe it as case law, where specific elements are historically and empirically collected, and then as supporting material, we often write guidance documents, even though this is a rather complicated and not necessarily a fast process, because it often takes years to publish those guidance documents. Now, within the medical product life cycle, and since nanoproducts or products go into the same process, there is certainly room for dialogue and interaction. And in fact, it's not just a linear process, it is a life cycle in a real sense, because information from post-market research often leads to the improvement and development of better products. I also mentioned here some of the accelerated special review processes on the very right side. These are also published. And I put it there because during the last 2 years I had often a lot of questions. So this information is also available, you can look it up. But if there are specific questions towards product, do not hesitate to ask. One of the important things that I want to point out here is that we are in a process of changing how we engage with patients and consumers in a sense, whereby the feedback that we obtain and the involvement of patients is critical to defining regulatory processes. And if you think about regulatory processes and how long it takes from the idea to an approved product, it is just too much time. And if you think of the costs, it is just too expensive. So anything we can do to speed this up, and certainly the involvement of patients in a meaningful way, is very critical in that. And I think that's where some of the paradigms have to shift, and that's where we at FDA do very active research and engagement. Now, we do have a plan to all of that, a strategic plan for regulatory science. This is also published, and you can read it up, and certainly deals with some key issues, namely to build a core and sustainable research and science infrastructure at a regulatory agency. And historically, that hasn't been the case, and yet I think it's an absolute necessity, and we need to enforce and reinforce that also with policymakers and with the legislator and certainly with Congress. We defined some of the strategic priorities, many of them very well known and clearly identified as priorities. We have to change toxicology, the way we do things. We have developed organs on a chip. We need to validate those, and certainly we need to do that also in context of accelerating the way that we assess real-time wellness. And I think we need to make, as a government, significant investment in that. The questions of diagnostics was raised quite frequently, and I think it has a significant place in that. Clinical trials and precision medicine are clearly in the focus. Product manufacturing and quality becomes important also in the context of generics, because we do not obtain clinical efficacy data when we get generic submissions. As such, we have to focus on the quality of the product. We have to understand the manufacturing processes, and that's a lot of work that goes into it, and it's essentially left up to the regulatory agency to produce the evidence and make a decision whether the unknowns are of high risk and whether this product can get to the market. Emerging technologies and emerging sciences, this forum, this meeting, this meeting of scientists and policymakers here is a very important element of that, and that is something that we have to enforce throughout society, and including other stakeholders, and I will perhaps at the very end reference some of the tools and infrastructure that we developed at the agency. Big data, diverse data, and real-world data plays a very important role in speeding product development up. Certainly, food safety and preventive system in this area, and preparedness towards emergencies and medical countermeasures in this area, is one of the science and research priorities when it comes to regulatory science. But we also need to invest more into understanding social and behavioral patterns in a society, and as I mentioned, make consumers and patients part of this. And last not least, it is very important, as you can imagine, where we obtain products from manufacturers across the world, that we understand what actually went into this product and how the manufacturing processes were constructed, and as such, a development of a global safety net is critical. Now, how does a consumer get a classification? Well, there is a formal request strategy, and the formal request will lead to a designated route that is on a ticker, and there's a time frame for it, namely 60 days. It's legally binding. It does not involve a dialogue with the sponsor, and it is basically the route that the approval of this product is going to take. It can be appealed, and if you want to know more about it, please use the reference to get the information. If you have specific questions for your product, approach the FDA. But there's also an informal product classification dialogue, which involves the sponsor and the submitter of the proposal. It is interactive. There is no formal process to it or a formal decline, and it opens up the opportunity for early stage discussion. Now, combination products. We do have an office for combination products, as I mentioned, and I listed here some of the contact points in case you have specific questions in this context. We also discussed accelerated approval or special pathways for approval. Here are the fast track, breakthrough therapy, accelerated approval, and priority review major consideration points. This is also available to get into the detailed information, and I would encourage you, if you consider such, to take advantage of it. Now, path forward, I think I said it many times, dialogue and building preparedness with appropriate resources. And the best way to understand how a regulator is going to deal with a product is through early engagement. We, as an agency, of course, desire to have coordinated framework across regulating agencies, other government agencies, so that products which fall in between agencies can be also addressed, and that industry and developers have a clear pathway to that. Well, again, the regulatory agency can play a critical role. It has significant economic impact. And in case you are not aware of the dimension of it, FDA regulates about a quarter of every consumer dollar spent, which amounts to about $2 trillion a year. This process is a rather complex process, and I would say there is opportunity in the complexity, but we know it involves science, it involves legal questions, it involves the art of medicine. It involves policy making. But it also involves management and effective management and the building and maintenance of management structures. And certainly, it does involve the engagement with political stakeholders and engagement with politicians at the country that we are responsible for. I offered you an outlook into the toolbox, specifically of the office that I'm leading, towards the facilitation of such activities. And I'd like to mention the Centers of Excellence in Regulatory Science and Innovation, which are academic institutions, currently actually six. We have them listed there. For internal communications, we build a network for scientific working groups. And if you know enough about the FDA to understand, it is a very a diverse structure, actually, with not so clear report structures. They are defined, but they are not straightforward. It's very important to coordinate scientific expertise in working groups to build a resource for decision-making processes. We also support a intramural research grants support, critical to stimulate research and collaboration. We have a technology transfer office, which is also engaged in building partnerships. And the BAA stands for a broad agency announcement, which is a very funny name for a flexible contracting mechanism that can do two things for the agency, at least two things. One is horizon scanning for new sciences and technologies that support the mission and the regulatory responsibility, but also evaluate and build regulatory science capacity at the agency. And it can be a mechanism to address grassroots problems that evolve in the centers in a very nimble and flexible way, because it takes altogether probably 2 months to have a contract. And any one of you who's ever interacted with the federal government knows that this is a record time. We have many different contracts that support regulatory science, and I think if enough interest is there, I can follow up to delineate some of the mechanisms and the opportunities that we have built in the past. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I was close to fire the first shot, as we have been learned yesterday afternoon. Thank you very much for this comprehensive presentation. I would like now our colleague from Africa, Dr. Roli, to present his views.
Thank you very much. First and foremost, I want to thank the organizers of this summit for inviting us. That answers the very first question, what progress has been made since last time. I think the fact that we are here today and we have already been accepted in the Nano Working Group is a big step forward for us. Apart from that, in collaboration with other countries, we belong to the International Medicine Coalition, the International Coalition of Medicine Regulatory Agencies, Authorities, which has, we started with 20 countries, they include the US FDA and all this other, European Union and other countries, and on the African continent, Nigeria was invited with South Africa. So we work together on work sharing. We have work sharing arrangements. For example, if a stringent medicine regulatory agency has inspected a facility that has applied to us, we do not need to go through the whole thing again. Sometimes we give it an abridged evaluation. And that has saved us cut our registration time by more than half, and saved us significantly saved our costs of inspections and other areas. Besides, I didn't introduce NAFDAC properly. It's the National Agency for Food and Drug Administration and Control of Nigeria. We regulate products for more than 170 million Nigerians. And all these products include all the foods, the chemicals, the drugs, medical devices, bottled water, all these, so many different other products. Approximately, we regulate more than one third of the products that form Nigeria's economy. So it's a huge burden on us. That is why maybe the organizers might have some problem trying to track me down initially. But I thank them for doggedly going ahead and trying to track me down. So this is we have a collaboration with other medicine regulatory agencies that, in the current global environment where products have become very, very complicated. You take a drug, for example, the active ingredient is manufactured in one country, the inactive in another country, maybe transported and coupled in a third country, and then transported across international boundaries and used in another country. It is almost impossible for even the topmost regulatory agencies to single-handedly, effectively regulate these products. So that is why it has become very necessary for countries to collaborate, and we are very happy that we have been invited to this working group here. On the second question, what will I do? What risk am I willing to take if a patient's life is on the line and there's a product out there that has not yet been approved? That question, I worked as a scientist at the University of Texas Health Science Center in San Antonio for more than 10 years. And I could understand when Professor Ferrari was presenting, I saw his frustration. Because working as a scientist, I saw very good candidate therapies for serious conditions sometimes discovered by scientists. And on the one hand, you have this good candidate therapies. On the other hand, you have the patients who are suffering and cannot access good quality medicine. Sometimes they have exhausted all their possibilities, and yet you have these medicines, and it's going to take 10 years and maybe hundreds of millions of dollars for these products to get to the patient. So it's a big challenge. So as a regulator, what I have decided to do, and because we have had a problem also with herbal medicines in Nigeria, some of them we find out that they've been used and they've been efficient in managing some other conditions. And yet, because they can, those people do not have the money and the scientific know-how to get the approvals, the patients are suffering. These nanomedicines here, when I came, I've not been very close to this area before. And so, but I heard one thing, that all the mechanisms have not been, the details sometimes are not known yet how they act. It's not known fully. There are still questions that are there, unanswered questions about their method of action. But I believe that if we see a product, and this is the approach that I have adopted. In Nigeria, we had a problem when some African countries, and even we have an incidence of Ebola virus, and we adopted a different approach. If we see that a product is effective, and but it may take a long time to get to the patients, and we have done toxicological tests and we find out that it is not toxic, I do give, I do waive some of the conditions and let it go to phase four clinical trials, so that some patients who have no option, exhausted all their options, for example, a cancer patient who has exhausted, used all options, but is going to die anyway. If you give them, if they give informed consent that this product can be used on them, then we allow the condition, I mean, the product to be tested while we collect results, and also make sure that maybe prolong or save the life, save that patient, give them an opportunity to be healed. On the third question, what are we going to do with nanomedicines, the generic nanomedicines? Like I said, I'm just coming into closer contact with nanomedicines for the first time, having attended this conference. But I already planned that when I go back, I will set up a nanomedicine desk just to make sure that we follow what is happening in the area of nanomedicine. Of course, we're going to treat them just like other generics to a large extent. I am very happy, I'm very lucky that I came here. I found out that there are some professors from Nigeria who already belong to this group and have formed a nanomedicine group in Nigeria. So I have them there, and they will be our consultants in this area advising that nanomedicine group. So I believe that we will treat nanomedicines when they come to Nigeria, just like we have treated these other generics. We have an open-minded approach to try to, once we have established that they are safe and efficacious, we try to cut down the cost and the time for them to get to the patients by doing whatever we can, maybe giving them abridged approvals and then doing post-marketing surveillance to make sure that the patient have access to these quality medicines. So I think that's, in a nutshell, that's our approach to these three questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much also for your clear answer to my question too. Last but not least is a colleague from Brussels working in IMI, Fadia Sadala, and I would like now to give her the floor to present IMI and to make the link between IMI and the regulatory aspects. Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you very much for inviting me here. As you can see, I'm not, how to say, a regulatory agency, but we are a public-private partnership with the pharmaceutical industry. And what we would like to show here is how our project, which are supported by the European Commission and the Federation of Pharmaceutical Industry and Association, can have an impact on regulatory aspects and eventually have lead to better medicine. So I will first acquaint you a little bit with IMI. So it is the largest public-private partnership worldwide in health research. So this is an initiative from the European Commission and the European Federation of Pharmaceutical Industry. They both joined forces to address bottleneck in drug development. And by doing so, they are, how to say, bringing some funding support. The European Commission is bringing 1.638 billion euro, while the Federation of Pharmaceutical Industry and Federation Association, sorry, is bringing 1.425 billion. So the European Commission is mainly supporting university, SMEs, and mid-sized enterprises, patient organization, and so on and so forth. So these are they are receiving funding from the Commission, while the pharmaceutical industry is not receiving funding, but is coming with its in-kind contribution. And this in-kind contribution is made by FTE, so mainly how to say, researchers, scientists working in the industry, is coming with databases, coming with samples. So this is what we call the in-kind contribution. Recently, with IMI2, we have opened a new opportunity for other funding support. This will come through associated partner and charity, and this will not be, of course, AFPI companies. So in this other company, what we are looking for is, of course, having additional expertise that we do not have in AFPI, neither in our, how to say, applicant, but could be represented here by all the industry devices, imaging industry, and this will complement, how to say, the spectrum that is needed to address bottleneck in drug development. So the total contribution here for IMI2 is about 3.276 billion. So what is exactly the research agenda in IMI2, along which our call for proposal will be delineated? So the strategic research agenda is totally aligned with the WHO priority. And as you can see here, is mainly what we call the unmet medicine needs that this strategic research agenda is, how to say, about. So we have a list here of, how to say, important major disease, let's say. We are talking about antimicrobial resistance, osteoarthritis, cardiovascular disease. These are really large burden disease that for which we need to, how to say, put some effort in the research to make sure that we end up with at least how to say, tools, technologies, which will facilitate the development of the drug. In this WHO priority, we have as well as in our strategic agenda, which is not mentioned here, the tools and technology which will be how to say, used to develop product or methodology or guideline which will help the development of these drugs. And among this technology, of course, the nanomedicines is part of this research agenda. So how does IMI work? So the key concept on IMI is, as I just mentioned, is to focus on unmet needs. First of all, it's the pharmaceutical company for the time being who are deciding on the terms of reference of a call text, what are the scientific priorities that they would like to come with in a particular call. And for the first time, this pharmaceutical industry, which were not used to work together, have decided to join forces and to work openly. When the call is published, then it is a competitive call. So what we are looking for is really excellence to make sure that the project that will be selected for funding will, how to say, end up with an outcome which will benefit at the patient. So when the project began, it is really a kind of association between all the stakeholders, which are part of this collaboration. So you have SMEs, small and medium-sized enterprise, you have patient organization, you have regulators on board, you have HTA bodies on board, you have, of course, academics and pharma industry. So all these stakeholders agree to work together towards the same objective and the same goal. And by doing that, they agree of sharing their data, disseminating their results, and make sure that the in-kind contribution coming from the EFPR industry is really complementary to the input of the academic and the other stakeholder that I just mentioned. So what we'd like to think is that we put, anyway, the patient in the center of our priority. And it's around this that the priority are more or less, delineate, and that our call are published. So what exactly makes for me, the importance to be here today is that the outcome of our project will really have an impact. What is the outcome of our project? As I mentioned, it could be new products, it could be new models, it could be guidelines, it could be standards, it could be biomarkers. So all these standards and methodology will be then tested and implemented in industry. And this will probably have an impact at the end, if this is validated in an industry, have an impact on the regulatory practice. And hopefully we'll end to have better drugs and have an impact on medical practice. So this is it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much also to you. I think what the presentations have shown is a certain degree of alignment already, but nevertheless I would like to ask the panelists whether they would like to comment on some remarks their colleagues have made or whether they have questions before I then turn to you in the audience. For example, one element I could imagine is, do you all share the 9 strategic priorities as indicated by our American colleague, for example? Or this could, or other divergences. So this could be an element, but you are free if somebody wants to take the floor first.
I didn't hear your question, sorry, could you?
No, I think what I wanted is to invite you all, mm-hmm. to respond to remarks, presentations having made by your colleagues. Whether you disagree, whether you agree, and one element in this regard is, for example, because it would lead to the further alignment, could you all agree on the 9 strategic priorities as they have been presented by our American colleague?
If I may...
yes, no, please.
When I have listened to my colleagues here presenting all the requirements that the regulatory agencies are about for nanotechnology or for any other drugs, I see very often aspects that we are dealing with in IMI. For instance, we heard about the education and training of personnel or even student or at the level of the university. So IMI is also taking care of this aspect, meaning that there are projects which are really not only for students and for PhD or postdoc, but are also for continual professional development. And these are in the field that we just mentioned in the regulatory science. We also have projects which we will not call education and training project, but much more project which helps, patient awareness on drug development process and R&D, how this patient could effectively be part of a research project if they do not have the adequate, information. to not only understand what this research is about, but to help sharing their experience with their disease and how this disease and how this information can help the research itself. We also have projects which are on patient-reported outcome, and we are sure that this project helps also the regulatory agencies in different aspects, different agencies that we mentioned here, that these are not clinical trials, but these are very important in terms of pharmacovigilance, pharmacoepidemiology, and this project at IMI has been now up and running since the beginning. Some of them has already produced some definition and some guidelines that are probably already discussed with the regulatory agency, and some other are still ongoing. So for the time being, we do not have yet the outcome of this project. But what we try also to do is to help the scientists, the applicant consortium, by preparing some guidance so that they will have the information that is very important for them. So right from the beginning, at the very early moment of the call of the topic of the project, of the project, that they integrate and they already initiate the dialogue with the regulatory agency. Because this is not done hand in hand. During the project development, you can't arrive at some point of your output of the project and go visit the regulatory. So we try to make sure in these guidelines that we are really raising awareness of the research applicant on how to approach the regulatory agency and how to discuss this. So that's it.
Thank you very much. As I have seen that co-panelists have taken a lot of notes and our colleague Ehmann is already raising the hand, so please start.
Yeah, so the European Medicines Agency publishes every 5 years a roadmap, 5 years ahead, what are our main goals? And so I was limiting the presentation so far to nanomedicines, but this is much more overarching. So what's our mandate and what we want to achieve in the next 5 years? And maybe just citing as everything is online and there's actually public consultation on these strategies as well, but I'm now reading from our website. So addressing public health needs, facilitating access to medicines is one of the major issues, and optimizing the safe and rational use of medicines. And then there's sub-bullet points how you can achieve these goals and within the next 5 years. Transparency was one of the last ones, very important. Patient involvement into decision-making, another one. And I think we achieved a lot in the last couple of years towards transparency, towards patient involvement. And network optimization. So coordinating these 28 different member states and even more agencies within each other and making the best use of its resources. Global regulatory environment. These are just some bullet points. I think I don't go through all of them. There are certainly overlaps, definitely in the strategy of tackling the major diseases. So antimicrobial resistance was a major thing, but we see the pipelines are filling now. So there is a certain overlap. There might be some specificities on different regions. Maybe that's the main message.
Thank you.
Are other co-panelists prepared to comment? Yeah.
In general, I think we all have common priorities, and transparency is always there now to communicate with patients, with public in general, and wherever there is smaller groups, these orphan diseases and so on. There has been a special call from the minister to have a survey and invite patients to come and contribute from their experience what type of help do they need, what that disease brings to their life, how it limits it, and so on. So this consultation process is always encouraged whenever there's a new policy or any new technological advances made. They're trying to put these products to better use, and hopefully with a different kind of approach. Also, Health Canada is a program, I'm sure most, regulators have this too, special access program. So if the drug isn't approved yet, but the physician can justify why this is the best option for their patient, especially for last resort type of therapy, then Health Canada can release that one application to that particular physician with the agreement, of course, that the company would agree to do so. So same happens with medical devices as well. Anything that's new on the market and there is a promise to it and there is sufficient evidence that this is safe and shows the promise and benefits seem to be there, there is a review that happens very quickly to allow 24-hour turnaround in some cases, if it's a life-saving measure, to allow for that to happen. So I think our common goals are the same, serving the public and to the betterment of their health.
Thank you. I saw Frank wanted also.
Yes, so one of the things I would like to underline, there's a lot of dialogue actually going on between the organizations, and I think there's a lot of alignment as well, opportunity for augmentation and synergy, like things, big data sets, or we call it big data. I mean, it's sometimes also called real world data. I think I would prefer to call it clinical data and clinical research data, post-market data. I think those are certainly areas where we absolutely need to exchange and collaborate and synergize ideally, but also in the areas of, you mentioned patient-reported outcomes, patient preferences, training. We can certainly benefit from each other in training programs. We have a very strong program developed, and it just recently was published in terms of a core curriculum on regulatory science education and training priorities. So you can look that up and find that, as well as the you know, the call for a clinical trials network, and a trials network that has expertise, that is prepared, and that can be, let me call it, recycled. It doesn't have to be rebuilt. It doesn't have to rebuild a clinical course and clinical expertise in order to deal with the subsets of diseases that we need to develop better products for. And in that context, the CTSA Trials Network in the US, as led by NCATS, one of the NIH centers, certainly has a lot of infrastructure built, and yet there are also lessons to learn, and that's where we hope we can work together and make some good progress.
Thanks, Frank.
If none of the co-panelists want to intervene at this moment, you? No? No? Okay, then I would like to open the discussion to you all. I would like to ask you that you just briefly indicate where you're coming from, and if you could target your question or maybe a comment to somebody concretely. I think that would be in the interest of all of us. So who will be the icebreaker? Professor Hunziker.
I'm Patrick Hunziker from Switzerland. Thank you very much for the progress you are reporting here. This is really encouraging to see how international collaboration is strengthened and how we really see things move forward. Thank you very much for this. I have a question in terms of cost efficiency for our patients. What we see in the whole domain of healthcare is that there are efforts to make medicine more accessible to patients, even in patients who have little money, in countries where we have limited resources, which is worldwide. And we see this effort of becoming more cost efficient along the whole line of product development. So the pharmaceutical industries have to focus, have to really work on being very efficient. And as the regulatory process also is part of this development and a cost, a part of the cost of the final product, I would like to understand a little bit if this is a factor in the regulatory agencies really to contribute to cost effective drug development, or if this is a different world where money is infinite and you can arbitrarily grow in expenditures for regulatory purpose. How is the world on your side?
You want to ask somebody directly, or is this
no?
Okay, then volunteers, Frank.
Yeah, I like to talk about stuff like that, obviously, so I put my light immediately on. Well, again, I think I mentioned it in between the latest analysis from a typical pharmaceutical product from idea to the market is about $2.6 billion right now. It used to be about above $1 billion, and now we got the latest numbers, and you know, you can debate, of course, it differs from product to product, but the short message is it's incredibly expensive, and we talk about access, and we talk about affordability and sustainability. I think we have to rethink the model, and we have to be critical of it as we currently do it. And I think the regulatory agency's opportunity is where we influence the cycle time, where we save time in the approval processes, and also where we leverage drug development tools, biomarkers, and let's say changing toxicology as we do it. And I think one of the major gains we can obtain by shifting perhaps risk, shifting risk from non-clinical or preclinical stages through meaningful, validated analytical systems into the early phase of clinical development. But again, there we need, of course, validation of drug development tools. And in the early clinical phases, I think we do have to make a significant push and investment into what I call real-time wellment or well-being and health assessments, or make a significant investment in real-time measuring of physiological parameters, because otherwise we can't take that risk. And I think in terms of mitigating the risk once we see changes, I think that's something that our arsenal of treatment and intervention strategies has, but we have to be transparent about it, and I think it's a question of dialogue. Also, later phase of clinical trial, shifting risk from, let's say, phase three into phase four, post-market. For that, we need nimble, transparent, and meaningful surveillance systems. We need to involve patient feedback. We need to be able to engage in a very direct and nimble way and record, track, and address side effects, unwanted effects, and certainly understand it better. Currently, we probably only capture about 10% of adverse events, also because it's typically reported through healthcare professionals and or insurance companies. And I think there are opportunities to improve. But I also think that we need to include the insurers. We are the world champion of approving new products in the US. It may not help us if the insurance companies don't reimburse for it. So when we talk about access and if we talk about affordability, insurers play a significant role. And certainly, even though FDA does not regulate physicians' practices, physicians are a major partner as well, healthcare providers, physicians, and I think we can do better and we can do more to integrate them into the dialogue. So those are just a few thoughts on that.
So just a short comment on this one as well. This is absolutely seen in Europe as well, especially under the current constraints in the different systems. And what we started to do is we have more dialogue with the HTAs, with the health technology agencies, in a very early stage. So basically in the stage between phase one and phase three, we give scientific advice. And into the scientific advice, how the drug development should proceed, what kind of endpoints you put in your studies. There we have the payers involved, and the payers then said, okay, but if you want to have this product reimbursed, we need to see this and this and that. And this is of utmost importance because we see products coming through as well, but they're just not unaffordable. And then health technology agencies in certain member states say, this is not within our budget. This doesn't satisfy our quality system in terms of saved and patient lives and so on, and that's why they're not reimbursed. So there's a high effort now. We offer this actually together even with the FDA, some of them, and definitely within Europe, scientific advice together with health technology agencies, which I think is one move in the right direction. And then I'd like to concur with Frank to mitigate risk by early dialogue with the agencies. We try to highlight this as well. So there is proof that if you engage earlier, the failure rate is lower. The failure rate is lower, you drop the cost, basically. This is another initiative. And the last one is this kind of early access. There are different early access schemes coming up now, I think, in different regions internationally. We recently launched the adaptive licensing pathway. It's an initiative where we're currently piloting, looking at very promising drugs addressing public health needs, and they go through a qualification process, and then there's more regulatory support during the procedure of the drug development. And the other initiatives, I think this is a bit looking to the future, where we see how much data we can shift from phase 2 to phase 4. So maybe giving an early access to a small proportion of patients, and then during this access of patients, we monitor them very carefully, and then could put the burden of further evidence on the later stage. It's not that easy because having a product on the market, the big companies know that. I mean, you have to look at patents, you know, you have to look at market exclusivity, this all plays a role. But there are absolute initiatives looking into this direction, how to ensure there is access to the medicines and that the medicines are really reimbursed and are available to the patients.
So, it's José Carballido from Novartis in Basel. I must say that this is my personal opinion, but I think that all the industry is trying to be very efficient. This I can tell you, we see every day ourselves. On the other hand, we have many approaches here that they are even personalized or very close to be personalized. And these are the ones that they are more difficult to be developed. It's not only the cost, because the industry is going to really to make a major impact in the patients. And I think that maybe one opportunity that we have here is maybe with the IMI, because that is where basically the companies, together with academic institutions, can share, and they can maybe have these big databases, maybe advanced biomarkers, maybe do things that will facilitate overall, so they will not be for one particular company, but they will facilitate maybe these advances. And I wonder if maybe you could give an example of the IMI one, maybe to see if there have been something in particular that facilitate, or maybe if this is not the case, what is the gap that still could be covered with the IMI two to reach this kind of, or close this gap that we have?
We can talk eventually of the project of the first IMI one. And as I mentioned, we discussed the patient's outcome, reported outcome, and we have two projects, one in the field of asthma and the other in the field of COPD. And they have, these two projects, the first one was about stratifying the patient for severe asthma. So this means that you do not have to give the same medicine to a patient which suffers from, how to say, symptom, but which are not as severe as the one who is classified under this stratification of patient. So this is one of the projects that has led to, highlight the importance of the participation of patients, because they are the ones who are in the center of this project and reporting. And I think there is a publication just this week on this project, on really having the right place for the patient in the research project, meaning just not just having them for, how to say, kicking the box, but having them also to really share their view and how they feel about their disease, and having an input on the research itself. And for this has also to go with the financial contribution to the patient organization that are participating to the project. So this is one of the patient-reported outcome that has, very, very good impact, let's say, on IMI, and this is one of the flagship projects. But we also have the education and training project. And for instance, we have the project on safety science, so preclinical safety in medical research. And this has led to, a continuation of the project in in IMI 1, call 1, we had 4 projects in education and training. One on safety, one on pharmacoepidemiology and pharmacovigilance, and the 2 others were on, PharmaTrain was more on curriculum and syllabus and preparing, courses that were already there, but putting them together and having a center of excellence for the university, which will follow this kind of curriculum. And this project were ending this year. They have had a chance to join forces, the 3 of them, and they have decided to work jointly on certain criteria of quality and excellence, on a certain quality in terms of learning outcome and mainly on e-learning, how to make sure that the students, the pharma industry who is having, people who need to have this continual professional development but who are not in the situation that they could go and attend 1 week formation can have also this e-learning platform so that they can follow as well the courses. And the fact that in the beginning of the IMI, we had 3 different projects, 4 different projects, and that at the end they joined forces and they are exploring a way to make sure that they capture all the outcome of the project of the first stage and they put it together to make sure that there will be a continuation of that. I think this is also a sign of a good outcome of the project. So. I mean, we have so many examples I could give about PROTECT.
My name is Heinrich Haas, coming from BioNTech, a company in Mainz, Germany, which develops tumor vaccines. And I would like to catch up with Professor Hunsinger's question regarding the costs and extend it to the efforts. What we are developing is nano, because we have a particulate carrier for targeted delivery. It's also a new medicine, what we call ATMP, a gene and cell therapy product. And it's also a personalized product as we intend to, or we are having in development, personalized medicines for patients in development. And we have efforts and requirements from 3 different complex sites, which makes us sometimes life very hard. And I'm wondering if you have any initiatives to facilitate and to adopt the regulatory procedures according to these requirements of new medicines, which are not just, let's say, a blockbuster product where you can sell 100,000 or millions of medications and then get back the money you pay for, but where you have much more diverse and complex efforts which come basically from different sides, not only nano, but vaccination, personalization. Do you have any efforts, for example, to facilitate the mechanisms of localization, like release analytics and so on, which are very complicated? Is there anything in your minds going on?
Yeah, well, I'll give it a try. So one of the things that I would say is you should be definitely looking into the accelerated approval pathways that we offer. Right, and special approval conditions for even compassionate use. So if you are working on new systems that are more complex, they will be certainly importantly also tested or reviewed for safety, and they were reviewed for efficacy. And that's not going to change. but there are pathways under which conditions, in special situations, for example, for emerging disease, let's say infectious diseases, threats and such kind, and as such I would make reference to the published information. So those are regulatory pathways that one can use under the circumstances that there is either a special need, unmet need, justification for accelerated approval and review, or compassionate use. There are just a few examples. Is that going in the direction that you wanted to go?
Maybe it could be necessary to, or could be useful to somehow modify the whole protocol for regulatory criteria for such kind of products, because we are talking of completely new, different kind of products, and then the old routines are not really suitable anymore.
Yeah, very short. I mean, in Europe, we established this first committee of its kind, the CAT, the Committee for Advanced Therapy. So they're really sitting experts from all over Europe there on a monthly basis and discussing exactly these kind of type of products. So just repeat what I said before, engage with regulators wherever you intend to file first, but engage as early as possible, maybe even on a national level. I don't know where you're based. And register as an SME, because you save a heck of money if you do this, wherever you go later on. And then in terms of having a product on the market, because registration is one thing, talk to HTAs as well as early as possible. Because in the end, you want that the product is used as well, not to have your billion-dollar product on the market and really engage, engage. You cannot lose. I think you only can win with this.
My name is Stefan Müllebach, and I'm chairing actually this working group on non-biological complexes at TI Pharma in the Netherlands. I very much welcome your comments and the question raised and the answers given here in this panel. And I think there is no doubt about the tremendous progress in a lot of aspects. Nevertheless, the question is, we have an approach depicted now where a top-down approach is given. And the question for me is, sometimes it's very difficult to go through such an aspect or approach because it's difficult to have access to that. On the other hand, as we have seen, regions are very different. And for me, the question is, in a more approach from down to top, are there thinkings, especially from the regulators, how some collaborations in this public-private partnership could be in approaching and improving regulatory science and taking advantage of different knowledges which is coming in. And I would be quite happy if the big, or let's say the present regulators could shortly comment on that. And what do they see as a good platform to do that?
Who would like to take this up?
Well, I can start out and maybe my colleagues will add. So, Stefan, yes, it's well received, or it's a certainly a reasonable question to ask. There is dialogue going on, and if you call it top-down, you're making probably reference to the law, and in the U.S. specifically the case law, or the RECs, or the central federal regulations, the CFRs, and then, of course, the case law that we generate in terms of procedures that we establish. But don't forget that we have over 50 consortia and advisory boards that are advising the agency, and those are not government employees. Those are experts in the field. And we do benefit in our decision process very much from other stakeholders. We do form public-private partnerships that help to identify problems and help us to understand where we need to change the approach, and certainly also address the question if review processes need to change, that needs to be facilitated. And who could better facilitate that than the public through their political representation? So I think there are some meaningful structures in place. I'm not saying that we are able to address all problems, but if those are significant inhibitory elements, then they need to be brought to the top of the attention. And I think we have built communication channels, and I think, again, through public-private partnerships, there's an opportunity. So maybe we can develop this culture further.
I see nodding, so I think the answer is sufficient for the time being, at least. Charles. You want? Yeah.
Thank you for your discussion earlier on. So I was wondering, since digital medicine is most likely going to be a part of nanomedicine in the future, how each of your regulatory agencies are approaching the approval of digital medicine and how this is going to be integrated with the approval of nanotechnology? Because I know that the FDA already in the US approved the first ingestible digital pill. Thank you.
So can we just clarify this digital medicine? Can you define a bit what you understand under digital medicine?
So usually it's some kind of sensor that records information and tracks what's happening in the body that is coupled to the medical agent.
Diagnostic and treatment with slow release.
Mm-hmm. Let me try first and see what we can come up with.
Sorry. Okay.
Oh, sorry.
If you mean it's a diagnostic tool that somebody would ingest and it would record whatever for purposes of defining a disease or condition, so is this a medical device we're talking about?
In the US, it was a pill, like a pill you take from a box, and that's an electrical sensor that tracks what happens in the body once you take the pill.
All right. And what happens after? Does it release from the body, or?
It degrades, yeah.
It degrades. Okay. I guess it would have to go through a regular review process and verify what happens when it degrades in the body. Does it introduce any toxic elements or not? It wouldn't be any different than a regular devices, for example, imaging sensors that you add to get a better image for diagnostic tool, and then the material you inject is just for contrast, and it just disappears afterwards. So I think it would follow a similar pattern unless there is a specific difference how it functions and there is more risk involved. It has to be looked at as to what it is to begin with, more specifically.
I only wanted to say it's not only diagnostics. So there are ways to deliver materials that is very close to the nanotechnology. That basically you could have a kind of sugar that will penetrate and will deliver your particular product. You could use optogenetics to express a particular gene inside of your body. So you will have a therapeutic effect. Is a kind of bridge between what I believe that nanotechnology will be a part fundamental of all of this. Digital will be almost now a synonym here of very, very, very new. It doesn't need to have a computer.
Okay, Beat, then you, then.
When I see this international panel and I hear from Frank that you have about 50 organizations that are sub-organizations or up-organizations that give you consult, I ask myself, to what extent would an approval of guidelines on an international level be elaboratable? How, if we sit together, you dream actually from that in a global world you would have global standards, and that when you go to the FDA in the United States or whether you go to EMA, you get the same level of requirements. And that seems very difficult. When I listen to the single voices, when you look on the scale, for instance, in the car industry, a lambda sonde was only possible when the European made a law and said we have to do it, and then within 6 months, the lambda sonde was delivered. And in medication, actually, you could think of that there would be a process of acceleration at the moment where the framework of guidelines for the approval would be quite the same.
Yeah, there definitely, since a long time, this harmonization efforts, the ICH, the International Committee of Harmonization, this everything is public there, and on quality, safety, efficacy, so there's a massive harmonization already ongoing. And in reality, if you look at the drugs, there are daily teleconferences between the major agencies about what is necessary, what is not necessary. So I think it is so harmonized already that it's rather interesting to look at where the differences and why there are differences. And most of the time, there are good reasons for this one. Because especially if you want to have a product successful on the market, you want the whole market. You don't develop this very expensive, as mentioned before, products for one market anymore. It's not cost efficient. So you need at least US, Japan, Europe, and ideally the whole world, basically, to have it as a market. So there was, for example, for generic biological drugs, so we call them biosimilars, there was a massive effort from this industry to harmonize this, that these biosimilars can have one major clinical trial, phase 3 trial, which then is sufficient for US and Europe, and this wasn't the case in the beginning. And this is only a very, very small fraction. I think we have 16 biosimilars, or maybe 20 now authorized, something like this. So if the drug comes to a certain stage, there is an immense harmonization already there in the drug industry, pharmaceuticals. Interesting it gets, I think, for devices and the theranostics, as mentioned there. So this is maybe something to explore further.
So I'm going to try, I have a lot of questions, but I'm just going to try and limit it to one particular area. Let's just talk about the aging population for just a second, and because it was brought up a couple of times in the presentations. One of the things that happens is when you reach 65, you usually have between 2 and 5 comorbidities. And as all of our parents age, they are taking anywhere between 1 and 15 pills a day. And the first part of the question is, if there's already approved drugs, and then you have consolidation of formulation, so you can reduce the amount of preservative, say for eye drops or something like this, because of glaucoma and several things, it should be easier to go ahead and get those approved and not go through the entire process. That's the first part of it. But let me just extend it a little bit further and tell you where I think it should go. Is there a way to go ahead and approve the three-dimensional printing of these 5 pills on demand at your local pharmacy with sensors for each layer? Because it would do 3 things. One, it would give the person 1 pill. It would be customized, and the last part of that is it would also reduce the amount of the cost for clinical trial, because you would get a feedback of every time you take a pill as it's dissolving at each stage going through your entire intestine. This is not science fiction. We're actually doing some of it, but to try and put all of that together simply is... regulatorily, it's very difficult, and I understand why. But from a technological standpoint, just like the FDA, the EPA, technology is always, or regulation is always 10 to 20 years behind where the technology is. So any insights would be greatly appreciated.
Why is the courage? Frank, you're reluctant.
Yeah, well, go ahead.
Well, from our standpoint, it shouldn't be difficult to approve such a medicine. In fact, we attempted a system like that of individualized medicine, where you go to, we wanted some pharmacies to be within the hospital where the doctor can prescribe, and then the pharmacist there on extempore, we mix some of these products and make one pill that, or maybe just one combination that is acceptable or more convenient for the patient, to reduce the number of different products. But all that, the different side effect contraindications have to be studied in details, and once there is no particular contraindication that will stop making just that one pill, I think we have no problem with it at all.
So I'd like to differentiate a bit between the clinical trial application you just mentioned and the healthcare system functioning better by, I don't know, 3D printing the drugs in the pharmacy. And I think I'd like to comment on the latter one, because I think this is member state issues in Europe, but if you look for an innovative member state who's maybe under constraints and demonstrate with all the security measures, the first one will always be going through all the hurdle, of course, but if you demonstrate that this is efficient and this is cost efficient, because I'm not convinced yet that this is really so much cheaper for the healthcare system than anything else, new technology and so on, but if you demonstrate this, I could imagine you can get run a trial somewhere, and if this is efficient, definitely other member states will copy. Now, beside all this, I see different stakeholder interests there as well. So the people who produce the substances for the time being, are they happy that you produce them there? Are they happy? Who pays for them? If you combine them, what kind of legal requirements? What about adverse drug reactions? I mean, there's a lot of things to consider. I really hope this will take place. So this is fantastic news, and this goes ahead. But I think the first pioneer has to go through a lot of hassle before this implements. And I really hope somebody will try first trial, maybe in a small society, and then this will be expanded.
I think it would be nice to come back to a significant role of the pharmacist, for example, as we had decades ago, to be able to individualize treatments to the extent. However, you also recall that just a few years ago, we had enormous issues with compounding industry in the context of injectables and the safety of injectables. So it's a very difficult issue to discuss. What we certainly would need is better monitoring and quality of manufacturing processes in place that are so nimble and reliable that one has confidence that that can be done in a meaningful, also economically meaningful way. So, is this possible? Yes, I think it will happen one day. How near in the future, I wouldn't want to speculate, because we have, of course, law, and we have legislation, and we have things that would have to change quite significantly.
I just wanted to just put the sharp point on this. When I say print these things, I'm not talking about mixing them and printing them. I'm talking about printing each individual one in one delivery vehicle. And as they are dissolving, like if you're already taking 5 of the pills or 10 of the pills, the pharmacokinetics is not much different if you're putting them all in your belly at the same time. And you could have this so you have a different layer, a different sensor for each one. And as it's dissolving, it actually can send a signal to your smartphone. So I wanted to make sure that we were talking about the same thing, because what you brought up about the compounders, completely agree. It's a nightmare. But if you have a hermetically sealed system that's controlled by the manufacturer from beginning to end, you also have another compliance thing that actually is very good for some of the, shall we say, more illicit drugs that are being stolen. So.
Yeah, so I think there is opportunity, but you also would probably agree with me that it's going to take a few steps there. And coming back to the electroceuticals, or let's call it digital medicine approach question, you know, we definitely deal with the question of personalized or personal health information, the security thereof, the question of encrypting it in very small devices, which then takes additional firepower from the processor and battery power and all those kind of things. And we don't have good solutions at this point in time, right? It will come, and it's good to have dreams, and certainly at some point it will make a real economic sense as well to the benefit of the patient.
As we have the poster session in a few minutes, I would propose I have three, and there's a fourth, and then I close the list. So you're number one, two, three, four, Mira. So by that, yeah, I'd be very brief, and we collect this all together, and then we have one or two answers. Okay, then you start with your exam. Michael.
I just a very short, first of all, I'm Mira from Israel Tel Aviv University, but I just want to comment regarding that, because I had many comments and I wanted to give up, but that's just an example. Regarding the EU, it was an EU project that was called Skin Treat, and they did personalized. I mean, you get the biomarkers, you get the levels of the skin, the water, the genetics, and you automatically produce the right cream. And it was confirmed, and they went through, and it's not a big difference because the chemicals are the same. Doesn't matter where they go through. And it's, but the cosmetics, it's much easier with the regulation. So this is just an example, and it was the EU, and the EU went off on with the industrial. So that's one point. And I think we just can, regarding the previous comments, reduce a lot of you know, any money and sources and everything by convergence, by the broad, and the convergence is the American initiative, but trying to reduce the differences between the regularity and commenting to Dr. Ehmann what you said about definition. We don't define really yet what is big data, what is the privilege. We don't embed the new schemes of analysis as fast as it could, and just by converging the effort and reduces, we can go much faster. And personalized medicine, all that is not defined yet, neither big data. All those are big balloons that we have to go further and define. Sorry.
So thank you very much for this great session. My name is Avi Schroeder, and I'm from Israel. And in the field of nanotechnology, many times we'll see an amazing paper which will, for example, show a nanoparticle that delivers four drugs at the same time or five siRNA strands. And that will translate into a company that would be established, a startup company. And then you'll go and you'll ask the CEO, what are you doing? And they'll downsize to a nanoparticle with one drug. And you'll ask them, why is that, or one siRNA? And they say, oh, it would be a regulatory nightmare for us to go with the best technology we really believe in. And my question to you as leaders, do you see a role of the regulatory bodies also in encouraging young companies to actually go with the cutting-edge technologies and bring them to the clinic, and not just going with an okay technology, which probably really won't make a huge difference in the pharmaceutical field? Thank you.
Completely different question relating to what Frank said about redefining patients as co-researchers. Researchers work within a certain agreed framework, but patients don't. And is there any scope for regulating the sources of information that a patient will be coming to you with, which could be a whole diverse thing in terms of reliability, from really good data coming from a responsible patient support group right through to urban myths and what they read off Wikipedia or whatever. In a sense, the question might be, should we regulate the medical parts of Wikipedia if we are going to be introducing patients? How do you handle that sort of thing?
I'm an old medical person, and I would like to ask a question. I'm very much impressed by the enormous competition within pharmaceutical industry. The question is not whether this is good or not so good, but I would like to have a comment of one of the regulatory people to this question. to this enormous competition?
Yes, only one question. When Beat was talking about global efforts, that depends on the needs. You know, after Second World War, it was possible to have the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which were principles. Then in Latin America, we had the American Declaration of Human Rights, because you are the FDA people, so advanced in optimizing these procedures to approve drugs. Do you foresee the possibility through probably the World Health Organization to have principles, universal principles, that can address the voids? For instance, now you have a representative of Africa here that can be a catalyzer in Africa, but probably that will be the best way to accelerate and optimize and respond to the voids. For instance, in America Latina, we were trying to search and we didn't find, but voids in the protocols to address the incorporation of nanomedicine and nanodrugs.
Thank you. So we have mainly four questions. This was more a comment, Mira. On patients, new cutting edge companies, competition of pharma companies and universal principles. And as I think you have hinted to our African colleague, I would like Ms. Ori to respond to this very last question. On for the other three, I leave it to you, others who would like to take it. But please, if you would like to respond to this very last question.
Yes, on whether we're going to try to convince the WHO so that there should be a program for nanomedicine, definitely yes. Particularly for me, I intend to be the voice on the African continent, and luckily I have been the chairman of the first WHO membership mechanism on spurious substandard fossil labeled falsified counterfeit medicines. And so I definitely have a voice at the WHO, and I definitely intend to use that opportunity to try to get the WHO to pay more attention to nanomedicine. Now that I have been here and begin to understand the huge opportunities that this area of medicine has.
Thank you. Who volunteers for the patient question? You would like? Okay.
Say something about the IMI project, which is a EUPATI, European, how to say, patient academy. And the idea is that there is an education or information program on different aspects of drug development. And for the time being, the course has begun, I think, 1 year ago. And we have already 50 students which has followed, not students, they are patients, who has followed the course. And this course is about regulatory aspects, about advanced therapies, about what is really new in the field of also drug development, R&D. So this might help.
Thank you.
Yeah, but the project itself is built that there will be, a program for courses for 1 year, and there will be another, round of students also following the same classes. But it is split in three specificities. So the first one is the classes, face-to-face and e-learning. The second one will be, create a kind of Wikipedia, okay, where all the information will be, available to the patient there.
We have to close it. Sorry to
interrupt you. So there is something.
And he's difficult to convince, I can tell you. new companies at the cutting edge? Frank?
Coming to your question, I think, what's a regulator's role? You have to safeguard patients as well as trying to promote innovation, and we try to find the balance. New technology, anything new is always risked because there's unknowns, and unknowns need to convince us, and it takes more than having a generic on the market. But in general, of course, we are open, and again, engage in early dialogue. I think I can speak for all regions, and we want to see you guys on the market for sure. Now, coming back to two other questions, maybe, just very briefly. Competition, for sure, competition is good. You see it in the price drop. When a second one is on the market, it drops immediately the first price. Now, again, there's a massive debate about how much competition is good, how much competition in terms of generic competition does prevent innovation. There are massive debates between, mainly in the US, basically, because the lawyers are very good there. So it's very complicated, but in general, competition is a good thing to promote innovation and drop the price in the end as well for the patients as well. The last thing, I think, defining patients, if I understood correctly, maybe just one initiative, I think there's a certain company brought an app for your mobile phones basically now, where the patients can get their own data from now on. And I think this is fantastic, and this is the future of everything, or could be the future of everything, because I think Stanford University demonstrated recruiting patients for a new trial, 20,000 people, took 2 weeks instead of 5 years, so to say. It's maybe a bit of science fiction, but all these laws in terms of who owns the data, what about informed consent, how can you take things forward? If the patients own his own data and he decides, I push forward, I share this data, this could be a potential solution to a lot of problems. But that's a personal opinion.
But this opens a totally new debate for which we don't have the time now, I'm afraid. So I would like... Unless you would like to add?
We all covered most of the questions in general.
Frank?
I think one of the questions we have not addressed is multi-drug combinations in new designs and more meaningful ways of deliver them. That's a tricky one because, of course, current drug approval processes take into account combination products, and I think that's probably one way to go. But I think we do have to also look towards some of the approaches to shorten the drug development process in the different phases and take advantage of some of the shifting risk, whereby I could imagine that it would be in the initial first-in-human a staggered putting it in. I think, you know, we have to represent the best interests of the patient, and if you take the risk to dump in everything at once in a completely new system, it's a significant risk unless you have a very nimble system that monitors physiologic well-being and you start at a very low concentration, and those approaches exist in clinical trial designs that can be done, but there is not much precedence of it. And in order to move this forward, I would say there are opportunities, I think, with public-private partnerships. There are opportunities through consortia and interest groups. Define the critical aspects, make suggestions, propose ways forward, and don't leave it up to the regulator to tell you how to do this. Suggest it. And if it's reasonable, and if it's sound, and if it generates the buy-in and the comfort of a regulatory agency, I think you will have success.
I know that I'm a very bad chairperson because we have heavily overconsumed the slots we have been given by Beat, but I think it was in the interest of all of us. So I will be very brief in concluding by thanking our panelists, congratulating them for the achievements in organizing and cooperating among themselves till now, and inviting you all, as we have now a forum in the form of the International Pharmaceutical Regulatory Forum, to challenge them. I think that's the best way to move forward. Thank you very much.